He's worth it. Get him out of there, he's worth it. Get him out of there and say, pass me not, oh, gentle Savior. Y'all, come on, come on. Savior,
acted proud against them. So you made a name for yourself. As it is this day. And you divided the sea before them, so that they went through the midst of the sea on the dry land. And their persecutors you threw into the deep as a stone into the mighty waters. Moreover, you led them by day, mounted pillar, and by night with a pillar of fire to give them light on the road which they should travel. You came down also on Mount Sinai and spoke with them from heaven and gave them just ordinances and true laws, good statutes and commandments. You made known to them your holy Sabbath and commanded them precepts, statutes, and laws by the hand of Moses your servant. You gave them bread from heaven for their hunger and brought them water out of the rock for their thirst and told them to go into possess the land which you have sworn to give them. Amen. I want to preach from this up today as we continue this series. As God begins, continues to shift us, I want to talk from this on praise for the past and the present. Amen. Praise for the past and the present. Amen. The purpose of this word today is to share with God's people, is to remind us that if God did it for our foreparents, past, he can do it for us now in the present. During this particular time of our text, Nehemiah and the people of Israel had made major accomplishments with the vision that God put in his heart. They have survived the constant attacks of the enemies because they were focused and persistent with their cause of purpose. For as a result, Nehemiah realizes that spirituality is just as important as physicality. Therefore, as the Feast of the Tabernacles are approaching them, according to chapter number 8, they asked Ezra, the scribe, to teach for them what is known as the Torah. And as he teaches them, the people began to repent of their sins, confess of their sins, and praise God for delivering them from their sins. And while they are convicted by the sermon of Ezra, they began to praise God and recall the history that God had with their forefathers. And they began to uplift God for these reasons. They uplift God because the text says of the perception of God. Verses 9 and 10 states that fact for us today. It says, you saw the affliction of our fathers in Egypt, and you heard their cry by the Red Sea. You showed signs and wonders against Pharaoh, against all his servants, and against all the people of his land. For you knew that they acted proudly against them, so you made a name for yourself as it is this day. For the people in Nehemiah's day and the Feast of Tabernacles began to rejoice and to celebrate God because God had, through the teaching and preaching of Ezra of the Torah, they had implemented the scriptures in their life. And as they began to implement the scriptures in their life, they began to recall and to recollect what God had done for their fathers. And as they began to reflect upon God's grace and mercy upon their fathers when they were in a foreign land, they began to rejoice because of the meticulous and specific ways of God. And in this particular text, verses 9 and 10, it proves that God is a God of perception, because the text says in verses number 9 and 10, it mentions that he's looking at our afflictions. Verse number 9 states that fact, says, you saw the afflictions of our fathers in Egypt. Which basically means that God is observatory. He's looking at our afflictions. Text basically means in the Hebrew, to see. That God sees the afflictions of their fathers. And they began to praise God because they realized that God alleviated the afflictions from their fathers. They began to look at themselves and to know that he was also looking at their afflictions. But he also, in a tense, is looking at our afflictions. And just to know that God has no respecter of persons. And what he has done for others, he can do for you. As the scripture says, many are the afflictions of the righteous. But the Lord delivers them out of them all. Here's a helpful indicator. If you are a believer of Christ, if you are saved, you will go through affliction. You will encounter situations that you wish you could not go through. But every so often, God has to allow some affliction to visit our address. But the good news is, even though he allows it to come, but he's still looking upon the affliction. The text makes mention that you saw the afflictions of the fathers in Egypt. And I don't know about you, but I'm just blessed to know his eyes on me. Some people want other people's eyes on them. And sometimes they roll their eyes. Sometimes they blink their eyes. Sometimes they even close their eyes. But I just rather have the eyes of the Lord upon me. Because if I want the eyes of the Lord upon me, then I have the best looking down upon me. Grandma used to say, he sits up high. And he looks down low. They have the eyes of God upon them. He's looking at their affliction. But the text also says that not only is he looking at our afflictions, he's also listening to our appeals. Because of verse number 9 says, not only did he suffer the affliction of their fathers in Egypt, but the text also says, and he heard their cry by the Red Sea. He begins to note and they begin to praise God because they begin to remember. There's no need for us worrying about Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the others, because the Lord defeated Pharaoh and his army in the Red Sea. And before they got to the Red Sea, the text makes mention according to Exodus 14, that the Lord tells Moses, you got to cross the Red Sea. But now in order to cross it, I have to work my ways for you to do that. Not going to swim through it. Gonna walk through it. text says that while this was getting ready to transpire, people of God, no doubt crying out to God.
Amen.
The word cry basically means that they are crying because not only do they have the eyes of God upon them, but they also have the ears of God upon them. They want God to listen to their appeal. But the text says that in verse number 9, and he heard their cry by the Red Sea. That all of them, in a unison aspect, and also in a place of unity, began to call upon the name of the Lord. And the text says that he heard them. In the Hebrew, he heard them, which basically notes he listened to them. You already have a tag team blessing right there, that the Lord is not only looking upon them, but he also is listening to them. And this ought to give us a reason to praise God, because when you got the eyes of God looking upon you, and when you have the ears of God listening to your cry, you ought to praise God, because whatever you are going through, he has the power to fix your circumstances. The text says he heard them by the Red Sea, which is a very interesting thing, because what they're getting ready to do is going to prove how much faith they really have. It's going to prove how much faith they really got in God, because you can shout, you can sing, you can jump, you can do all of that, but what really proves your faith is what you are getting ready to do in a Red Sea situation. Because the Red Sea shows us we have to put up a shut up. The Red Sea shows us we have to walk by faith and not by what we see. The Red Sea shows us, even though this is a situation out of our control, but if we trust God, it can be in his control, and he can use us as a vessel to show, here it is, the adversary, what others said can't be done, if we understand who is looking down on us and who's listening to us. The text says, church, he's looking at their afflictions. He's listening to their appeals, but he's lending to their adversaries. Look at the text, church. The text says, verse number 10, that while God tells Moses in Exodus 14 to get ready to cross the Red Sea, says that you got some adversaries who have treated you cruel. Treated you bad. The text says, verse number 10, they celebrate because the Lord shows signs and wonders against Pharaoh. Understand, Pharaoh is not his name. Pharaoh is his title. And oftentimes in the church, we don't try to make an impression upon our name. We try to make an impression or title. God tells Abram, I make your name great. So many times we are so fluent upon our titles until we begin to not even notice our name. I'd rather answer to my name than my title. I wish I had a little say. Because sometimes if those persons who can't handle the title and they focus on the title more than the name, then they really have an issue. The text says, church, he showed signs and wonders against Pharaoh, against all his servants, and against all the people of the land, that he looked upon their affliction, he listened to their appeals, but he also lent it to their adversaries. Watch this here. He tells Moses, when you get to the Red Sea, Moses, I want you to just stretch out your rod. And when you do that, watch this now, something's going to happen that you think is impossible.
Watch this now. And when it happens, it's not going to affect you. It's going to affect your adversaries. Watch the text. The text makes mention that as they begin to get ready to cross Red Sea, Moses and the people really don't want to do it. Then God talks to Moses. Moses again talks to the people and said, "The Lord will be with you this day. Don't you worry about it. God will make a way for you." And I just come to tell somebody in this part of the word, you don't have to worry about your adversaries. Because just like the Lord is looking down upon you, He's listening to the prayers in which you petition unto Him, He'll also take care of your enemies. Now here it is, church, you might not believe me, but I just want to tell you that all of us got somebody that dislike us. Don't matter if you're young, don't matter if you're old, all of us got somebody somewhere that dislike us. Your assignment is not to handle them, you let God handle them. I wish I had a church and crowd over here. Because see, sometimes we want to get agitated and aggravated with our enemies, and that's understandable. But we have to understand that vengeance does not belong to us. For Paul wrote down on pen and parchment, he says that vengeance is mine, it says the Lord. Therefore, you don't have to worry about your enemies. God will take care of them. Whatever Red Sea situation you may be facing, you give your enemies over into the possession of God. Let God handle your enemies. Watch this, y'all. They talk about the text, that is, they praise God because of His perception. He looks and He listens, but they also praise Him because of the preeminence of God. He says in verse number 11, says, "And you divided the sea before them, so that you went through the midst of the sea on the dry land. And the persecutors you threw into the deep, as a stone into the mighty waters. And moreover, you led them by day with a cloud and pillar, and by night with a pillar of fire. You give them light on the road which they should travel. You came down also on Mount Sinai and spoke with them from heaven and gave them just ordinances and true laws, good statutes and commandments. And you made known to them your holy Sabbath and commanded them precepts, statutes, and laws by the hand of Moses, your servant." Verse number 10 begins to talk about the name of God, that He made a name for Himself. Which means that God makes His own reputation. That He makes a name for Himself. And during this time, the people in Egypt are having Pharaoh on a pedestal. Therefore, God says, "I have to show them by hardening their hearts and sending 10 plagues unto them who's really in control. I have to show them that you don't put that much worship in a man. Because man, is not worthy of being worshipped. Worship only belongs to God. And therefore God even confirms in His word that I am a jealous God." You know, there is a such thing called good jealousy. I wish I had a witness here. You don't want your significant other just talking to anybody. That's good jealousy. You don't just want them hanging with some crowds. That's good jealousy. But I'm not talking about how long you be in the restroom jealousy, who you talking to on your phone and all that. I'm not talking about all that. But there's a such thing as good jealousy, because God says, "I am a jealous God, and no one should put no other God before me." Now we have to be very careful with that. Sometimes people got other people as their God. And God becomes irritated and agitated when we begin to place people on pedestals. All right, watch this now. The text says, verse number 10, He makes a name for Himself. says unto Pharaoh, me and you finna show down and I guarantee you, you gonna lose. I'm gonna harden Pharaoh's heart and the people's heart. I'm gonna put them in a situation to where they have to give me the glory. Watch the text, church. The text says that he focuses on his preeminence, which means nobody is in comparison with him. He is preeminent. He talks about his name in verse number 10, but this is what his name, his reputation did from verses 11 through 14. I notice, first of all, his division. The text says, and you divided the sea before them so that they went through the midst of the sea on the dry land. The text makes mention that God divided. The word divide is a verb which indicates to split, to break down, and even to separate. That God, watch this now, in order for the children of Israel to go through the Red Sea, he says, I'm not going to just allow you to swim. I'm going to flip the script. The text says he's going to allow them to walk, watch this here, because he split. He made a divide in the sea. Which means, watch this now, he had on one side water and on the other side water. Which further denotes, the text says, and they walked on dry land. Which messes me up because how in the world could the land be dry when it's in a muddy environment? What that basically tells me, thankful, is that I don't care and know what you're going through. Whatever the odds are, give them to the Lord and he will make your odds come in agreement to your situation. Is that anybody up in this church can testify? There's nothing too hard for God.
Can't deliver like God can, even the United States.
destroys Pharaoh and his army. Watch the text now. The text says that he threw them into the deep as a stone in mighty waters. Left side slow. Let me go to my brother. He threw them into the deep as a stone into mighty waters. Let me get over here. They slow too. The text says he threw them into the deep as a stone into mighty waters. What means that said, when the Lord threw them in the water, he didn't give them no opportunity to flood again. Can I tell you, when God cancels some stuff in your life, it's not gonna pop up again. He ain't gonna give no resuscitation and no resurrection to your problem. Only thing you got to do is give it to the Lord. You led them by day with a cloudy pillar, and by night with a pillar of fire. Scripture mentions there's nothing new under the sun. While going to the Red Sea, didn't know how to get there, didn't have no navigational system, God says, I'm going to create you a GPS. It's in the text. Says, in the daytime, I know you don't know where you're going. the shape of a cloud and you focus on that in the cloud. See, you think your little GPS system something. God done been there and done that. Whether it's day or night, the Lord will never leave you in the wrong direction. Oh, church folk, just don't open this shop. He'll never leave you in the wrong direction. Is there anybody up in this house can testify? I praise God for leading me. Because, see, sometimes people will try. Says that he gave them just ordinances and true laws and good statutes and commandments. You made known to them your holy Sabbath and commanded them precepts, statutes, and laws. While Ezra and the Levites are teaching, while Ezra is teaching this powerful sermon, the people. Begin to rejoice because they understand that there is now a transition in the text. What's the transition, y'all? The text says that when God was talking to Moses first time, he's in Egypt.
Amen.
The word Egypt, from a geographical standpoint, it means a low place. Now, in the transition of the text, he's in on rest. Mount Sinai. Let me say it one more again. The text says, in the beginning he talked to Moses in Egypt. Egypt means a low place. Now he's on. Mount Sinai, talking to Moses again, giving him what we know as the Ten Commandments. The people are rejoicing because, watch this now, that if the Lord was with Moses when he was down, y'all ain't ready for no church. It's preeminence. Now he gets ready to close. Begins to talk about the provision of God. Watch this now. The text begins with God, talking with Moses. Now he begins to talk about, as he gives his ways of perception, it transcends from the perception of God, the preeminence of God. Now he talks about the provision of God, and I'm done when I give you these two facts. The text says this, y'all. Says that God to Moses on Mount Sinai, he had a free meal for the children of Israel. Watch the text. Verse 15, y'all. You gave them bread from heaven for their hunger. For free. We gotta pay for it, right? But the Lord, oh God, help me in this church. He says, I'm gonna give you some free food. I'm gonna feed you some food from among high. Here, it just proves that God will provide. And I don't know who I'm looking at you today, but I come to speak into your life and speak into your heart that you ought to be thankful that you serve a God that He will take care of your needs. Some of us worry about tomorrow and what tomorrow is going to bring. Jesus said, don't you do that. You need to. you. I'm done. He provides. Watch this, y'all. Cornelius. I'm glad. If nobody